Hi there. Today I'm going to show you how to do my snakes and ladder stitch in a purse that we're going to make. Purse, a little handbag. And this stitch looks different whether it's round or flat. So here's my little swatch of it. Flat. Make sure I'm on the right side. Yeah, that's the inside. This is the inside. And this is what the outside looks like. So it's a nice tight stitch. Things won't fall through it. You won't have to line it if you don't want to. I don't line mine. So this is the stitch we're using. We're going to do the bag in the round. And then the stitch looks very, very different in a flat panel. So that's what it looks like in a flat panel. So very, very different. And it's because you're going back and forth, so stitches are slanting that way, then they're slanting that way. But it's still a very nice stitch. It's what the back looks like. So it's very nice for some projects, but I thought that this particular purse would look better in the round. I will do something else with that, but this is the stitch I want for the bag. So I'm going to do it in the round. I'm going to use this loom. This is from the Loops and Threads set. It's the purple loom. It's a little smaller than 3/4 gauge, but it's bigger than 5/8 inch. I guess you're technically still in the 3/4 inch range. And the yarn I'm going to use is Bernay Chunky. And it is a number 6. And I don't know where the color is on here. Faded denim. Faded denim is the color. And I'm going to add a second color in here and there. So I'm going to use two colors. I'm not sure where, just wherever I feel like adding them in, basically. And it's royal purple. And it's Bernay Chunky. Okay, so I'll just pause while I get set up and get these two great big balls of yarn off my lap. Okay, so this loom has about 30-31 pegs. That will give me the size of bag that I want. You can use a bigger bag, a smaller bag. It doesn't really matter, and it doesn't matter the peg count, because this particular stitch we're going to use for this is all done on one peg. So it's all the same row, one row over and over again. So very easy that way. And you'll just zip along when you get used to doing it. Anyway, first we have to cast on. So I'm just doing it without thinking here. Okay, here, you take this and you make yourself a slip knot. And I just make a really easy slip knot. I just take it, wrap it up like this so it looks like this, stick the yarn through. Pull, slip knot. So very easy, and I put it on the first peg. And then I just take the loom hook, put it in the loop, and pull up. Now you can use a different cast on if you like another one better, but this one is really will be really nice for the finishing up later. Okay, and we just go like this, take the loop, go behind the peg, in through the hole, and do that, take it, go behind the peg, around, through, and you just keep casting on that way. The crochet chain type of cast on, just done on the loom. Go. And we just take it behind, working yarn through, and pull. And we just go all the way around. Okay. And then the last loop goes on the last empty peg. You just put it on there and then pull it tight. And then you can just knit it over. Okay, and we just knit one over this way. There we go. Now, what we're going to do is go right into the stitch. Okay, so what you do is we're just going to go in front and knit over like a U-wrap. And then we're going to take the working yarn and go around the peg from behind and in front of it again and lay it over. So that's the same peg. And we're going to do a stitch that Theresa Higby named the purl over. And she gave me permission to use her stitch. So this is the stitch. It's made up of doing a U-wrap and then immediately taking the working yarn, coming around the front, go into, you pick it up, you put the loom hook here and pick it up, and it's just like you're actually doing a traditional knit. And you pull this loop, but instead of taking it off, you just take this and flip it back over, just like that. And you snug it up if it was loose a little bit, but you leave it fairly loose. Otherwise, it's going to get too tight for you to knit when you come back. You can check to see, is this loose enough I can get it over the peg? Okay, and then go to the next peg. Put the working yarn over it in a U-wrap. Knit it. Come around the front, same way, except instead now, you come in from the bottom, down, scoop it up, and put it over. And it was too loose for me to put over with my fingers. And come over, knit it off, and come back around in front again, working yarn under, over, scoop it up, and flip it over. See, usually I'm good at that. Knit it over, come around, okay. Pick this up, scoop it up, just so you can see what we're doing. We're getting a big loop here, put it there, and then we just snug it up. I have my tension done with this stitch because I've been working with it, so I tend to just go like this, and it's already the right tightness, and I keep going. I just keep going like this, but you'll probably have to work up to being able to do that. So you can go like this. Doesn't matter which way you do it, and come around, come under, scoop it up, and put it on like that, or, and then tighten it a bit if that was a little loose, or like this, pull it up and slip it over with your fingers. Doesn't really matter any way that you get it done. And that's all there is to it. And so I'm going to put you on pause, and I'm going to keep going and do a few rows, and then we can take another look at it. Okay, I've done a few rows, so here's the stitch coming in here. There it is right there. So we just keep going, and I guess we'll catch up when I'm about to change colors. Okay, so we'll see you in a little while. Okay, so I'm back, and let's just take a look at it now. You can see what it looks like. There it is, a really beautiful stitch. Has so much texture to it. It's really gorgeous. And then the other side is just really smooth. Very smooth to the feel. And look at that. You can't really see through it or anything. It's not holy. And so you won't have to line it. And it's really, really perfect with this yarn and this gauge. And this is about the size of it's a little tiny bit bigger than Charisma, and it is a number six yarn, but it's not a super thick number six, but it is definitely a number six yarn, and that's what you get on this gauge. If you wanted to do it on a smaller gauge, then you would just find a yarn, you do a few swatches and get a yarn that starts to look like this to give you the full benefit of the pattern. And I'll just take a look again at this one because I wanted to tell you why I named it what I named it. So let's get this one. Where's the top? Where's the bottom? Yep, there it is. Okay. It's pretty cool looking. Okay, so this is what it looks like when you do it in a flat panel. And I'm going to just stretch it out really hard here so you can see. But these things that you see neatly stacked coming down here are going the different directions. And that's because you're moving back and forth. But here's why I called it snakes and ladders. Here's your ladders. When you're doing it in the round, here's your snakes when you're doing it. And when my granddaughter was a bit younger, we used to play snakes and ladders all the time. So it has really fun memories for me. But there we go. So that's why it's called snakes and ladders. And that's a different look she'll get. And that swatch was done on this very loom. So that's what you get. Okay, so now what we're going to do is add in the color. And I have this yarn here, which I seem to have lost the end of. I think it goes this way. Not. Oh, it must have gone that way. Okay, I have to find the end, so I'm going to put you on pause. Okay, got the end. Now, I normally do a different kind of way of attaching yarns, but because this is such a thick thread and because I don't want any lumps or bumps, because when we're putting things in and out of the purse, I want to keep this really smooth, I'm going to do a different adding on of color. And the way I decided to add the color was, so I'll show you here, we've done right 2 inches here. So I'm going to do 2 inches of the blue, and then I'm going to do a few inches of the purple. And when I think I'm 2 inches from how long I want to go, I'll go back to the blue. So we'll have blue, then a bigger thing of the purple, and then blue at the top. So that's how I'm going to do this, I decided. Okay, so here's the purple yarn. So all I do is make that slip knot. So I just take it and make it into that. See, just this crossed, and hold it, and the yarn's coming, working yarn's coming from the bottom, so I just pull it through here to make a loop. That's it, slip knot. Okay, so we ended. Here's the yarn, and here's the last stitch that was knitted. So this one needs to be knitted, so we're just going to plop it on right here. Okay, and here's our end that we have to weave in. Here's the other end. Now what's going to happen is it's going to be a bit of a gap here. So you're going to tighten it when you come to sew in the ends, and the blue will be going this way. Keep that together because I don't want to tie a knot, although you're free to do anything you want. I just don't want to do that. So I'm going to go knit this over, and there's my first knit. I come over, under, and lift it over. And so they all have exactly the same stitches on them. And these are the yarns to weave in. And see, it's gonna, you're not really gonna see it. You just suddenly start with another yarn there. Okay, so then we come over to this one. We knit it over, come back around, under, pick it up, and over. I'm still going to do a couple more, but I think you've got the basics down by now. And there is a button on the lower right hand. It looks like a little gear. If you click on that gear, you'll be able to slow down the speed. So if you need to see this stitch again to really look at it, you'll be able to do that. Okay, so go over here, knit it off, back around, under, go up, scoop up that working yarn, and flip it over. Whoop, just flip it over and tighten it if you need to. Or if you need to, you can just go like that and pull it over. Whatever works for you. Okay, now we're just gonna go take a look, and here we go. There's our new color added in. Excuse me. There. Just all starting to come in there. Okay, so I'm going to go along until I'm about 2 inches from where I want the height of this to be. The width of it's going to be half of this because it's going to be folded flat. It's going to be a flat kind of purse. So, but you'll see when I get there, and you can choose to do anything you want. Use a variegated yarn already, or make it solid, or put in your colors any way you like and make any size you like. Okay, so I will be going for quite a bit until I'm close to ready to get to the end of how long I want it to be, so we'll catch up then. Okay, hey there. So here I am. I've got this turned inside out, but I'm as long as I want to be. And here it is. But what I've done is I've flipped it up because I'm going to finish the end before I do my flap. And the reason I want to do that, finish my end before I do my flap, is because then when I do my flap, I can be seeing with my flap where it's going to come down on here, how long it's going to be, and this will be nice and flat and easier to see. So I just want to finish my end. So I've turned it inside out, and I figured out where I'm going to put it together. I put stitch markers, and I've clipped it together here to show where my ends are. And my end is, of course, going to be my starting peg, and then the middle of it. And if you have an uneven peg, you just figure out a way to make it look the most even and be flat. It's fine if you're a peg out. And then I'm just going to do it together. And because it would be really hard for me to do it with this on the loom, I made another little piece so I can just quickly show you how to do an end. If you want to see an end all the way from the beginning, because I already started this end, then all you have to do is take a look at my cobblestone purse, and you'll see that. But I've done up to here. I've just done these few stitches, and on the other side, it's just you can just see it just makes a fine bottom. And so all I'm doing is I come up through two side loops, and you've got these two loops that you cast on with, so you can sort of see them here. Two loops, one, two. You can see them on my finger, two loops. And so you have two loops on each side, and all you need to do is put the two loops together, but you can use any attaching method you like. I'm just showing you one to make sure you know an attaching method. So I've come up through the loops, and then I go down through the next two loops, and then I go and look to see where I came out of to go up on the other side, and I go in there. And you just stay nice and loose because you can tighten it up. And then I've come up, so I'm going to go down the next two loops on this other side, and then I go back up the loop I came out of, and I look until I see the yarn that's coming out, and then I go up that side, and then I go down the next two loops and go over to the other side and go in the loop that I came out of. So this is just one method of stitching it up. I like it. It looks really good, and I'm on the wrong side of the blanket or the blanket the wrong side of the bag. That's why I turned this one to the wrong side. But it's exactly the same. I used exactly the same yarn and exactly the same cast on, so I'd be able to show you. So then I'm going this way through this one. So then I'm going to go up where I came out of on the other side and down the next two and up where I came out of. And so there you go. That's one method of doing it. And I just do it all the way to the end and I attach it. And then of course you tighten it. And what I do as I go along is I tighten it and then I do a knot here and there. And by doing that knot here and there, it just makes it a little more secure. So even if it started breaking apart, it couldn't do it all the way, you know, after a long, long time of use, because you're more knotted and there's less chance of anything. And then now we can turn it and look at this side now. And that's how it looks. As I've done up to here. And you can see you just have a nice bottom. Right? There it is. You can't really tell it from the stitches. Where, you know, where it is and where the stitches are. It's a really nice way to finish, but you're welcome to finish it anyway. And then what I might do, rather than leave this at the bottom of the bag, because that's what you're gonna have at the bottom of the bag, is this, although that's not so bad. It kind of just goes in, so I may leave it. But if you wanted to, you could go in and whip stitch this after to make it extra secure. And you won't see your whip stitching and you'll still have the nice bottom that you can't tell is a bottom. So that's how you do the bottom. So I'm going to go ahead and do the bottom and then we will catch up to do the flap and attachment. So I will see you in a bit. Well, okay, so I did finish sewing up the bottom and here it is here. And there's my sides, so you can see it's going to be folded at the sides. So I need to pick where I'm going to do the brim. So I follow the side up and go over one, and I follow this side up and went over the one, and the one to here. And so actually, I had my markers where I was going to have them, but I moved them down because I don't want them in the way. So from here to here is where I'm going to make the fold over flap. And then at the end, I will bind off the rest of it. They could be bound off first, but I would just as soon do the flap first before I bind them off. So I'm going to do the flap first. It would depend. If you bound them off now, you would have to get a new yarn to start the flap. And I don't really want to have to deal with a yarn to wind in the flap, because this is such thick yarn and I'll have one at the end of the flap anyway to wind in. So one is enough in there, I decided. And instead I'll just add one into the bind off row. So to start the flap, I'm just going to be knitting the same stitch back and forth for a few rows. So it's just doing the knit and then coming over, of course, and doing the purl over. And so we'll just catch up. There's no point in you watching me do it, because I'm just going to go back and forth in the area that I'm going to use for the flap. Now, if you don't want your flap to be the whole bag, because I'm going to have it come up and it's going to be close to the whole bag to come over and cover it, you can have a smaller flap. That would work just as well. However you want to do your bag and however you'd like your bag. And so I'm going to do a few rows and then I'm going to start decreasing. So I will see you in a short while. Okay, so I'm still doing just my few rows on the flap, and I just wanted to show you how to treat the end pegs, because the end pegs on the flap that's going to go over are now going to be the edge of the flap. And so I have done some test swatches, and it's just best to knit over and knit over back, and it gives you a very nice tight edge going down. At least that's what I found, but you can use a different edge if you want. So this one and this one will be your edges, but I just wanted to do a few rows down before I bound off, because this way, if I'm just going to move my pegs, but this way, if you got interrupted or something happened, you would never bind off too much, because when you get up here, you're going to see that there's way more yarn here. So that's good. So I just moved this over on top of the two end pegs so that I wouldn't accidentally bind them off, and I'm just going to bind off the ones here. So you just have to cut yourself a piece of the same yarn, and it needs to be about as long as this and then at least half more. And so we'll just do that, and we'll bind off. Okay, so I've got my yarn here, and I've put a needle on it, and then we need to anchor it. So I'm just going to anchor it right on top of the peg that has the orange marker in a slip knot, or you can tie any kind of knot that you like. It doesn't have to be a slip knot. And then we can start to do the bind off. And so what we're going to do is we're going to start by going up this first peg, and then down the second peg, and make sure you're on this side of the yarn. There we go, we pull it tight, and then we're just going to we're going to come around this way and go down this one, because we have to start out. We're just going to pull that tight and then come around, come back around this one and go down. So this is the third peg, and now we're going down it, and our yarn is behind that peg, and we snug it up. We want it to be nice and tight, and then we go up the peg before, and we keep doing that. We go between the two that we just worked on and back to the new peg, and we go down the new peg, pulling it tight, and up the old peg. So you just do that all the way till we get down to the last peg that we bind off. We'll do a couple more here. So we just did this. We go behind these two we just worked on, and we go down the new peg and up the old one and around and behind and down the new one and up the one before and then back behind and around and continually down, up and around. And so I'll meet you up when we're close to the end there. Okay, so here I am at the end of the row, and I go down this last one and up the one before and then all we have to do actually is go up it again, and that's it. we've done that, and we'll just need to secure this yarn at the end. Do a knot or something here at the end, and I'm just going to start taking it off the loom very carefully. I'll take the slip knot here. There we go. Off the loom. It's tight here. There, and my stitch marker. Well, which I won't need anymore anyway. So, and now start popping off the stitches, and that will have to be woven in. And I won't need the needle either. And make sure you don't go too far. But you should, you'll see the loom hook there. You'll see the marker, and you'll see that this is the last one here, and it needs to be secured. And so now these are off the loom, and I left mine a little bit, mine just made it, it's a little bit too short, but that's okay. And you just kind of stretch these out, and then this is going to be your edge of the bag here. Well, whenever you do this bind off, you have to just kind of stretch it out a little bit. And so, and we'll tighten these up, and this will be the edge of the bag. And now we're working on the brim, and we've got our bag edge right here. There we go. And we are working. So now it can just kind of hang free. There's our bag. And we're going to do a fold over brim to attach it. And later on, of course, I still have more that I have to weave in, but we'll be weaving in these ends. And so I'm just going to tuck them in there. And that's our bag and our brim, or our flap. So you'll have to decide how long you want to have your flap. If you want it to come down to about here when it folds over, or longer or shorter. So I'm going to do a few rows. Right now I've done four rows. I'm going to do a couple more rows, and then I'm going to start decreasing. So I don't want to have my brim too terribly long, just long enough to go over and secure. So I'll probably do a couple more rows, and then I'll start decreasing. So I'll just keep doing my rows, and we've just done our end, and we're going back, and we just work back and forth until we're ready to do our flap. And our stitch is going to be different on our flap, because this stitch looks different in a flat panel than it looks on the round. So it's going to be an interesting wavy kind of a look when it folds over. But you'll be able to see that. So it'll give it kind of a different textured look. But already, if you look, you can see that it's a wavy stitch in a flat panel, and it's a straight stitch in the round. So we'll get a multi-textured look where it won't really look like the same stitch, but the stitch will be working into it. Okay, so if you're going to have a really long flap, do more rows than I'm doing. I'm going to do about six rows total before I start to decrease, and I'll meet you up when we're ready to decrease. Okay, so I'm going to start decreasing then. Let's see how many total rows I did. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, so you can see how far this is going to come down. It gives you kind of an idea there. Maybe you can see that a little better, however long I see there, plus just a tiny bit more because it's stretched on here. So it's going to come down about this much on my bag, and I want it to be more down there. So I'm going to start decreasing. So I'm going to decrease right now, and I'm going to decrease each time I hit a side. I'm going to decrease, and so to decrease, I don't want to decrease this one because I want my edge stitch to keep looking nice. So I'm going to take this one here and move it over and decrease it. And if you find that it's too hard for you to move your last stitch, because we did the knit over and then we did the purl over, and if your purl overs were too tight, you can try putting your hook under it like this and pulling it a little looser. If it's really too tight, just put a knit over it. So just put one knit over it, and very loosely put the knit over it very loosely and knit it off, and then move that over. But I've got that moved over, and then I'm just going to take this and make sure I move the working yarn over with it and move it over one and tighten it up again, and then come over and do my knit over. And I'm going to have to take both of them over, but I'm going to take them over one at a time so it's easier, and then do my purl over. And then we're decreased, and it's just sort of going to blend in with the work. It'll be a little thicker there, but it will just blend in, and our edge will just start tapering in. And when we get to the other side, we'll do the same decrease. And we come back here, the same decrease. And so we'll just decrease a few times. And you're going to want to get it to where the length you want it to be and how wide you want your tip to be. And there's a number of different clasps we can do. You can have make a buttonhole in the middle. If you go here and find the middle peg and make a buttonhole and do a button. I don't like to do that because it's a purse, and I don't like having to put the button through the hole again and again and again and again and again. So I usually make a tab and then put it over and put a toggle or something on, or but I haven't even decided what clasp I'm going to use yet for it. I'm going to get it down further and look and see which one that I like the best. So, and I'm not too worried about it because there's a number of ways you can do it. And if the way I decide to do it up at the end isn't the way that you would decide, you can take a look at my cobblestone bag that I did. It's already on YouTube. And do the clasp I did there. I show how to make that clasp and do that clasp, but I will decide as I get further along exactly what clasp I want and how they look on it, depending how far it comes down, what looks the best. So we'll just decrease until we're down to the length and the kind of end that we have. And I will meet you up in a little while. So I have decreased, and I'm down to only 3 pegs, and you can see that it's coming down. And so here I am, and I've just done a decrease, so I'm going to come back and just knit over the end peg, and then I'm going to come and knit over 1, and then 2, and then do the purl over. And then here to the end stitch. Okay, now we could decrease down to 1, but I would like to leave myself a little bit wider base at the end and not have too pointy a tip, so I have room to put easily on whatever kind of closure I'm going to do. And you could actually move this middle one over, and you'd have a yarn over, and then you could make, you know, you could do a buttonhole or something if you wanted. I don't like to do that. So I'm just going to do a clasp of some kind, and you can make a clasp. You could make a clasp right here if you wanted to too. You would just go knit over and then knit off, and then knit it over again and knit off and knit it over again until you got a long enough thing to come on and attach to here and knit it over. And then you could have a loop coming over here and then bind off that one. But what I want to do, I prefer to never do that, because if that should wear out, it's a part of your knitting. So there's the end of your bag, or you're going to have to do a very rough kind of fix. But if you've attached it and it wears out, you can cut it off and just make another clasp. And it doesn't even have to be the same one. You can get a different color yarn or something. So I like to put them on separate, and that is the reason why. So now we're just going to do the bind off, and I'm going to do the same bind off that I did when we did this part. We don't need a very long one, so actually maybe we should just do the basic bind off and do a quick bind off. I just have to decide. You can do either. With the basic, we wouldn't have to cut it off, and it's only 3 stitches, and I think it would might blend in better with the edge because it's going to be so close to the edge. So in that case, I'm over here and I've done my one knit over, so that's all I'll do. And then I'm going to e-wrap it, and then I'm going to bring it over to this stitch. I'm just going to tighten it up a little bit. I don't want it to be too loose. I usually like to do them loose, but we're only doing 3 stitches. So I'm going to keep it fairly tight and then knit it over and give it another e-wrap. And then take this one and put it on here and knit it over. And then that's all we're going to do. And just take this loop off. There we go. And we're going to cut this yarn. And put it through the loop to secure it. And tighten. And yeah, I think the basic bind off was the way to go. Nice, nice tip here. And then we're going to put a needle in this, and then you're just going to weave that in. But we'll stretch out these stitches now, stretch out the purse, and take a look at how it's going to look. And stretch out that. And I like this, and I like how it comes down, and I really, really get this in the view. I really, really like the textures, and here you go, snakes and ladders. So this is the snakes and ladders purse. And now you could use your, like with me, I had used the 2 different color yarns. I could make a loop. And then put a toggle on here, and I could make that in the burgundy-ish, well, it's kind of more, I don't know what you call this color. It's a type of it's a type of purple, I think, kind of a burgundy purple or a violet purple. Yeah, it's more more pinky purple, I think, than burgundy. And that might look nice, or you could do it in the blue. Or what I could do is not have any clasp at all, and inside sew a magnetic clasp, and it would just come down like this, and then I could even just sew a button on it for decoration. that might look nice. There's a number of different things I can do. So I'm going to put you on pause, and I'm going to decide what kind of clasp I am going to put on here. So I will catch up with you in a few minutes. Okay, here I am with all this stuff here. So I had a big toggle, which I could have put here and then made a loop and used the big toggle. And I just had tried it for some other things with how it will work. You have your yarn through there and attach it like that. And then I had some bone kind of toggles in a number of, well, horn, I guess, or horn in a number of colors. And then I had all my buttons. But when I went through my buttons, I thought, ooh, I really like this button, and I think this button goes with it really nice. So I decided I'm going to use my magnetic toggles. I'm going to use a magnetic closure and just use the button on the top for decoration. So the button will sit there and it will close by just popping it like this onto the magnet. And I have my magnet right here. So there's the two pieces. They're very magnety. And they're nice strong magnets. I wouldn't use this on too thin a material, but this is a nice thick material and the magnets are working really well. So I'm just going to sew that on. The holes are very small, so I'll have to get a needle and thread and sew those on to attach it. And I'll be sewing on my button. And so I can do that, and that doesn't have to be on the camera. And then the other thing I will do is what I'm going to use are these things, and I'm going to attach them on the sides, and then I'm going to attach a strap to them that will be an adjustable strap that I got so that I can wear it around my shoulder, or if I'm hiking and I want it just around my hips, I can shorten it with the pad. So that's, I'm going to just put these on here, and I'm just going to put them on by opening up the clips and putting it through a couple of threads, and I can do that on the inside, so that's there, or I can do it on the outside. And so those will be my clips. Now if you wanted to actually loom knit yourself a handle, and I don't like to do that for my purses and things I have to carry with me where I go, and I want to have my phone and wallet and keys in here, I don't mind having a loom knit handle for shopping bag or something like that that I won't have to carry too far. Because what happens is with those is you can't adjust them. They are where they are, always that same length. There's no change or nothing else you can do with it. So I like to have an adjustable strap, and then I can just clip these on here, and my adjustable strap can go on to any purse I decide to take. I can take it and clip it right on to these. And I just got a whole bag of these on Amazon for a very, very good price. So it's enough for as many bags, water bottle holders, whatever I want to make and then wear around my waist. So I'm just going to go ahead and clip these on, put my magnetic things on and my button. And as I said, you can also use the clasp that's on my other bag, my cobblestone one on my channel, or any other kind of way you have that you want to clasp it. And so I guess I'll be ending the video here because the bag is essentially finished. It's just the finishing pieces, which will be in the picture that you see for the video. But I sure like this button. It just has this kind of a burgundy color that kind of matches with that more. And just kind of finishes off the bag that will be closing with the magnets. And so there you go. And I don't want to lose any of these pieces that I'm using, but just to finish now, I'm stretching it out and it's going to come down, look like this. I'll have everything sewn in. It will have the button on it, and it will just be a really cute finished purse. Okay, so here we are, and it's all attached. So all I did was I put on the magnetic, and I just sewed it on with navy thread here, and I used a kind of a purple thread here to help it sew on, and so it just comes over and secures nicely. And for the button, what I did is I took some of this yarn, and because this was a 3-ply yarn, I just untwisted it, took one ply, and used the heavy navy thread that was here, kind of an indigo color, to put on the button. But you can use any kind of thread, or maybe a thick embroidery thread would be easier for a big button like that. But you can put a button on anyway if you decide to do the button. And I like the way this button kind of went with all this. And then I'd had attached the clips. And so I attached the clips. I just put it through a lot of the work here. So quite a few stitches, so that it'll be strong and not pull on it too much. And I did that on the other side, and then I just clipped the adjustable belt on. And I had bought two of these on Amazon, and I already had a black one, so now I have a deep plum one and a navy one and a black one, and so I can kind of color match them to some extent and just keep putting them on all my different bags, because I also need swim bags and things, and shopping bags and everything. And this has this nice pad that goes on too, so that's just gonna really be nice on my shoulder. So there you go, it's completely finished now. And open it up, it looks like that on the inside. Pretty smooth, so nothing should catch on it, even though it looks very textured. This side actually feels a lot more textured than the inside. And there you go. And I've sewed in and woven in all the pieces. So anyway, there you go. And of course you can make any kind of size bag you want with this, and you don't have to have a button on, and you can actually make a buttonhole. And there's lots of videos on making a buttonhole too, should you want to do it that way and have a real button there. And like I said, my cobblestone shows you an attachment that goes like that, and you can attach it to something there too. So anyway, have fun.